If you need to pick your nose, do it now.
Hey there, goblins. Welcome to Goblin Salvage Rights. My name's Robert.
And I'm Eric.
And today's episode is about the very core of what makes subsystems in Pathfinder 2nd Edition work. Victory points.
Victory!
Victor Rico's points. I could go for some
Victor Rico's points?
Dude, I'd go for some Victor Rico's right
Victor
now.
Victor Rico's is good, but I hate the fact that they're like sign says Co's now. Like, hey, I'm going to grab a burrito down at Co's. You want anything? It's Victor Rico's, motherfucker.
Oh, they like changed the name. I've been there in like a month.
Victor Rico's on one side, and then the other side it says like apostrophe Co, C-O-S.
Oh, it's just like the shortening.
It's right,
like
right. It's like we're cool. We call it Co's.
Okay.
Anyhow, none of that matters.
Nope, not at all. Thanks for checking out the podcast. First thing we're going to do is talk shill a little bit and tell you about our Patreon.
A little bit of shilling.
We just dropped the biggest Patreon thing we've done so far. 4 pages of content, no pictures in there. So
we had to cut it down from 6.
It's stacked. It's thick. Thick boy. It covers our newest Goblin Iconic, the lore and the world building that he exists in. Mm-hmm. We've got some NPCs that you can pull and rip right out of there and put into your game. We've got some lore you can rip right out. I created a new subclass of the druid that
and
allows
it
you.
Fucking rocks.
It's pretty cool. I'm not gonna lie, it's pretty
cool. Yeah, I'm ready to shit can my Kingmaker character right now and just make that.
It allows you to play undead animal companions as fungal animal companions as a druid.
Yep.
So big Golgari vibes. Mm-hmm. If you want to check that out and support the podcast, also get access to our Discord, our special Discord. We have a public Discord you can go check out. No problem. We hang out there all the time. But if you want special direct access to us for whatever reason, you can join the Patreon and jump into the Discord that way and talk to us anytime you like. So yeah, shill over.
Done.
Eric wants to start a new tiny segment called Goblin Gratitude.
Goblin Gratitude. I don't want to make this weird, even though that's kind of what we do here. But I've been thankful for a number of things lately, and I kind of just want to see more of that shit in the world. So I'm going to go ahead and take that first step. I'm grateful for you guys at my Edgewatch table. So we've been playing Edgewatch for years at this point, and it's the same people. Nobody's dropped the game in like 2 or 3 years, however long we've been doing it. It's you, Robert. We've got Tyler is amazing. Jacques is amazing. Nick is amazing. Ben is amazing. We've had a steady location to do it at every couple of weeks for years at this point. That's not a thing that I've had a lot of in my life. And because of the five of you and how you approach the game, like you in particular are super, I was going to say fixated. The rules and mechanisms are important to you.
Yeah.
So I got to be on my game and get better at that. Tyler wants me to, I'm not going to put words in their mouth. Tyler's appreciation is for like the story and the world building and the details and the consistencies of character names, places, actions, personalities. Mm-hmm. And that's a lot for me. So I got to be on my game with that. Mm-hmm. So all five of you are pushing me to be a better GM.
And a lot of different
directions.
I've been
doing so for years.
Yeah.
So if I was in any other group with a rotating cast of players, I'd still be the same shitty GM I was 2.5 years ago. So I'm grateful for my Edgewatch group, and I'll just leave it at that.
That's adorable.
Yeah, well, yeah. We'll start strong, right?
Absolutely, absolutely. Oh, man, do I have to pick something now?
You don't have to at all. It's an optional thing.
Yeah, totally. I'm not grateful for anything.
No, everything sucks. I hate everything, especially you.
That's not true at all.
You can go next episode.
Hot seat. All right, and next episode, I'll pull some gratitude out of my butthole.
We'll trade off.
Awesome.
So we played a game Edgewatch week, is that right?
We did Edgewatch. We talked about Kingmaker, my game of Kingmaker last episode because we're doing these next week.
We're doing more videos now.
Yeah.
So I'm having trouble remembering what we talked about where at this point.
So we did Kingmaker. we did a cold open with a big fight. Mm-hmm. We had no idea what's going on. And
that was Edgewatch.
Yeah, a big demon attacked a waterfront area, which was cool as fuck. And then you introduced like this, you did this really interesting thing.
Picture Godzilla marching on Tokyo Bay. That's the effect I was going for.
Exactly. So Eric handed out these little colored chits to everyone at the beginning of the session when we were recounting what happened last session.
Yeah, what happened last session that was important. And you get a different colored cube, one of five colors.
And he doesn't explain how any of this shit works. He just starts randomly handing you cubes.
Surprise!
Yeah, and Robert is always like, what do these mean, Eric? What is the value? How do I gain more value? But I didn't do that. I resisted my temptation.
2.5 years of this shit.
And I literally just lined them up in color order on their own little square.
Right.
And then during the game, we also,
everybody had a small pile by this point.
We had a little pile, pretty much like one of each color. And we would be able to, activate NPCs that you had laid out on little cards, your NPC index cards.
NPC battle cards with stat blocks on one side and their art on the other.
Which is a product that he bought. He loves buying these little card things.
Love them.
And, but then you never find a way to use them.
I know.
So you just shoehorned it into this. I just tripped over this. And I thought it fucking worked excellently because you could only see the picture. You weren't supposed to read what the... what they were. Mm-hmm. So I had just two sitting in front of me. I didn't realize at first that I could pick any of them, but I had like one badass necromancer looking guy. And I was just like, I got
so
my
imagine
chip.
Three battle mats. Yeah. 1, 2, 3. 1 and 2 are sort of like the dock district with fantastic art. And then the third one was a ship in the bay. And I had a big old miniature about the size of this guy here sitting there in the bay on the other side, on the far side of the ship. The player characters had their miniatures around different parts of the battle mat. I threw a whole bunch of 1-inch poker chips of different colors all over to represent people in the crowd. Each one of those poker chips had a different colored cube on it.
Yeah.
So green cube on poker chip and a green cube on an NPC card means you can take one of the green cubes in your stash, pay me, and then pick that NPC and you get them. And you get to play that NPC on your turn. You get your 3-action economy that you would normally get on your turn. Mm-hmm. And then you would also get to see what this fun little NPC can do. That's either a level -1 all the way up to level 7 creature.
And then they would just like disappear into the crowd after you use them once. And then
pull the cube and they're not usable again.
And you replace it with a new card and there's a new person there.
So like the crowd was dynamic. And I was trying to. Yeah, I'm really glad you liked it.
Yeah, that was really cool. I was not expecting that.
Totally experimental. And I think like we're about to go into victory points. Mm-hmm. And I kind of want to take what we did as an experiment and then codify it using this. So that's a little project I'm going to have on the back burner.
Yeah, now that you mentioned it, and this goes into my idea, some of my ideas of how I want to implement victory points in my games and my systems. But that's basically the whole session is we did that, and then we did some like flashbacks.
Yeah.
And also we got
which
promoted.
I totally screwed up.
You didn't screw them up.
Well, I was trying to emulate the one we did back in like February or something that you guys just really loved. But I forgot that what I did back then was we did a single round of combat.
Yes.
And then we did the flashback.
Right.
I waited until an entire wave of combat was finished, and that was like 3.5 hours into the game.
Well,
so
it's funny because you told me a couple days before, you were like, Robert, I've got nothing.
I'm not
prepped.
Ready.
What do I do? And I'm like, I don't know. Dude, just plan a big fight. Like, everyone loves a big fight. Right, guys? Everyone just loves a big fight. So there was a big fight. I was like, yes, big fight. Let's go. Yep. And then we did like the entire wave of fights, and I was like, this is epic as fuck.
Yeah, there's
and then
three waves
like,
total, and you guys did the first one,
yeah,
and then the second one popped up just before 5 o'clock,
just before the session ended. And I was just like, let's go, I'm here for it. Yeah. And then you're like, all right, we're going back in time, and I'm like, what? What are we doing?
Well, see, that's kind of what I mean. Yeah, like, all five of you guys at the table, you know, you were getting your jollies off for like 3.5 hours. Meanwhile, a couple of us over here on this side of the table were like, I gotta role play.
Was it that
Eric,
painful?
Give me something, please.
Oh man, I'm sorry. And, I'm sorry.
I mean, it was for me as a GM.
Yeah.
Because
yeah,
you know, combats are fun and all, but I had like 3 pages of notes, and that fucking combat was like a quarter of the first page.
Oh wow.
So I just
Now you have a lot more prep
I didn't
for next
pace
session.
It well, but yeah, all that is to say that these cool little experiments that you can do using shit you buy from the Paizo website that. You know, you don't have to use them one way.
Yeah.
There's multiple ways to use them all. Like, for instance, these really cool beholder mugs. You can make them kiss.
Yeah, you totally can.
That's not what they're designed to do.
They're designed to hold
but
drinks.
But that's what they're doing for the next 90 minutes.
They can't hold this drink, though.
They really can't, no.
No.
No, these are baby beholders.
The baby beholders.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that was our game. It was pretty cool. We did a flashback, too, where we all got promoted except me because my character died.
Yep.
But my old character who died got promoted.
Posthumously promoted.
Yep. That was pretty cool. That was pretty cool.
And I was going to put him in the crime scene investigations unit with Carl.
Oh, my God.
But, you know, death has a way of disrupting those kinds of
absolutely
kinds of plans.
Absolutely. So yeah, let's jump into the topic. Victory points.
Victory points.
victory points. So in the section of the book of subsystems, this is the first chapter, because they're basically describing the framework with which they made every one of the subsystems. And if you're a longtime listener of the channel, you'll know.
And who isn't?
That we've done like almost every single subsystem in this book.
Yeah.
There's like two we haven't done so far, and that's because they're hella boring.
Yeah.
Like research.
And like maybe three people have watched these episodes, so we stopped making them.
It's true. But you did, Slick. We all know you did. Love you, Slick. But yeah, so let's jump into like the, let's just talk about like the core mechanics of how this is supposed to work.
Sure.
And then kind of talk about how we're going to implement them, or think about cool ways to implement victory point systems.
Yeah. Yeah. These are tools and not, you know, chiseled in stone guidelines for running your game. Mm-hmm. And if you have your book at home, I've got the GM core and I'm looking at page 185. Robert's got the old game mastery guide.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And what page are you on?
148.
Okay, cool. So do with that as you will.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I'm just going to read what it says out of the book right here so you get an idea of what the hell we're even talking about. Cool. It's a subsystem. You'll often find that your games could use a way to track progress towards a goal, so you don't have to just keep everything in your head. Me. This section explains how to build your own subsystems for tracking success via victory points. Many other subsystems throughout this chapter use these as well, though often by a different name. So you guys have heard us talk about the reputation system, the chase subsystem, mm-hmm. Infiltration. These are all specific subsystems that use victory points as the structural framework so that you can reduce the amount of overhead in running your games. And that's why I love them.
Yep. So the idea here is you basically, you pick a number, you pick a threshold of victory points for victory. Mm-hmm. And then the players do a series of role-playing and checks to accumulate Victorica points.
Mm-hmm.
So generally speaking, critical successes get you 2 points, regular successes get you 1, and failures get you nothing, and then critical failures decrease the amount of victory points you get by 1.
Sure. You just described one of the three kinds of victory point structures that they use, and that's the right. First one.
Yeah, and that's, I think that's the main one that they talk about. The other ones are almost like variations on that system.
Yep.
And this core system is effectively how, I want to say like 8 out of the 10 other subsystems work.
It's super additive.
Yeah, very additive. And they have, there's options for length and depth of the subsystems where you can have thresholds. Mm-hmm. So let's say that there's a great chart on the next page, 150, that basically says if you want a quick encounter that'll take up like a quarter or half of your game at like
a 4-hour game session.
Exactly. You can do a quick encounter that has like 3 to 5 victory points as the endpoint. And then the other options are for longer engagements. So a long encounter, most of a session, which is to me is hilarious because that could no table I sit at would you actually get 15 to 25 Victorico points.
I would cry.
I would cry, yeah. And then adventure-wide sideline and adventure-wide forefront.
Yeah.
And that's, I think, an interesting thing what we should talk about later, which is like applying the system to like long-term goals that the party has over the course of the game. Because when you look at like Kingmaker and how it's made, these are kind of peppered in over the Kingmaker.
Yeah, we actually started with one in Kingmaker. That's exactly. In my notes here.
Influence.
When we were introducing all of the non-player characters and trying to figure out how awesome we were in their eyes, we were trying to literally influence them to like us more.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So a really quick bracket here. You said a lot just now.
Mm-hmm.
And if I didn't know anything about victory points, none of that would make sense because my question would be, how do you even get victory points? How do you achieve 1 victory point? You do a success or a critical success, but like what? Are these skill checks? Are these combat checks? Are these successful spell blasts?
Yes.
I mean, right.
Anything can
depending
be
on the subsystem. Exactly.
Anything can be these checks. And that's kind of where the freeform part of it really, really begins to show itself. So we can say that we can make this a social encounter where we collectively try to impress someone.
Okay, I'm immediately thinking diplomacy and intimidate.
Exactly. Okay. We could make this, we're trying to literally fell a tree. so we can make survival checks or nature checks athletics checks to like chop down the tree. And then, and you know, a certain number of points gets us the tree falling down. Mm-hmm. But if we create, if we get past a certain threshold that's higher than the base victory, we can aim the direction of the tree to fall in a certain space or something like that. So the idea here is that you do a series of things, and that DC is like one of the things I love about Pathfinder 2nd Edition is because DC by level exists and it's highly, highly useful at all times. So if you have a 6th level party, you go to your GM screen, DC by level, level 6. If it's supposed to be hard, make it 2 harder. If it's supposed to be easy, make it 2 easier.
Right.
Bada bing, bada boom.
And if you have a check, like say influencing someone, to use your example, you can actually have 3 separate DCs. Does your player character have a skill that can get you the success? It's just harder. So let's say a diplomacy on influencing someone reduces the DC and makes it easier.
This is using an appropriate lore effectively.
Right.
Yeah.
And then intimidation might just be like the base DC, the middle, the moderate DC. And athletics, if you're mugging the guy, that you can do it, but it's a higher, harder DC.
Absolutely, absolutely. Or maybe they're...
Thievery is not applicable, but athletics.
Maybe they're enamored by your physical prowess.
Yeah.
Maybe so they're a Miri from...
Sure.
Yeah, exactly.
I think the reason why I bring that up, and it's why this entire section of the book sings for me, is because I played a lot of Pathfinder Society games in the early days of PF2 and even late PF1. And a lot of them in Starfinder 2, when I would run into encounters that required skill checks, it always seemed to be a binary. Do you have this or that?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Which one's higher? This one. Okay, roll that.
Yeah.
Every single time. And it, you know, the magic, the juice.
Does
the
it
juge.
Grind on you?
The voix de juge.
The voix de juge.
Just got sucked right out of the experience for me. And I know there's 100 reasons for that. But if I'm a player and you tell me, how are you trying to impress me? I love that question because I'm not giving a binary set of choices.
Yeah.
Maybe I want to, I don't know, I want to just take my occult lore that I've maxed when everything else is just dog shit low in numbers, and I'm going to try and see if I can make that work. Well, maybe that's not even possible.
You're like the person at the party who just like walks up to people and tells them facts about like weird animals and stuff like that.
Have you ever heard the story about the Shoggoth and the Beholder?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
I made their eyes kiss.
Yeah, I made their eyes kiss.
But yeah,
absolutely.
It's flexible that way. And, you know, the GMs can say, no, there's only one skill that you can use to get past this. Mm-hmm. Okay, that could be part of the story that you're trying to tell with the subsystem. Or sell me on a skill.
Mm-hmm.
And then I'm thinking, okay, high, moderate, or low.
Mm-hmm.
Or, you know, very poor or extreme.
Yeah. Is this applicable, highly applicable, or not very applicable to the challenge at hand?
Yeah.
And that's what I love about this. You use this little tiny table to set a number of victory points you need in order to show some sort of accomplishment, and you can make it as complex or as simple as you want. You could just have a single number, and if they beat it, they win. Yeah. Or you could have stages of success, which is what they call VP thresholds, where if you get 5, you get a basic success. Not basic success, that's coded language. You get a one kind of success. And then if you get 10 VP, you get even better success.
Cross your second threshold.
And then third threshold, you're hitting like, you know, the person in the influence system loves you and adores you. Or you have successfully snuck through the entire castle and absolutely no one knew you were there.
Yeah. And I like the idea of prepping the benefits from each success ahead of time.
Absolutely.
If you're trying to get the name of a confidential informant out of somebody, maybe the first success, they'll tell you where you can find them, but they won't give you the name.
Yeah.
So you show up there and there's 100 people there. Okay, which one is it? If you cross that second success threshold, then maybe you'll get the name of the location and you'll get a little bit of a physical description, man, woman, kobold, whatever.
Yeah.
If you cross that third harder to reach, maybe because you got aided by one of your partners and both of you have high numbers and you guys are just coming up with great ideas, circumstance bonuses, you cross that third threshold, maybe you'll get the name, all 3 of those. So having like scalable successes, it will cost me as a player to make smarter decisions and ask more pertinent, penetrating questions.
Absolutely.
Before I get in there and make that roll.
Yeah, it's more of a song. It's more of a dance between the players and the GM, rather than what skill do you have? Oh, yeah. I have this. Okay,
it creates a more proactive, engaged experience on the player side of the table.
Because there's nothing one of my biggest pet peeves at the table is when people roll dice, saying, "Oh, okay, I roll a survival check," and it's like, "No, motherfucker, what are you doing?
Right.
Tell me what you're doing. Mm-hmm. Okay, give me a survival check. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Give me a blah blah blah, or maybe even I'll throw you a bone, and I'll be like, the player says to me, you know, well, I want to track them through this, you know, damp, dark hallway, and I'd like to use my nature check to do so." Mm-hmm. If they describe what they want to do and the thing they would like, the skill they would like to use, I'll be like, "All right, yeah, that sounds like a great idea." And then I will come up with a DC. Maybe they want to track with their athletics or something like that. If they want to do it that way, I can give them a negative. I can just set the DC higher and then let them try and do it. Yeah. But I hate it when people are just like, "Okay, yeah, boom, boom. Here's my number.
I make a roll.
Yeah, yeah. I do the roll. You know, when players roll without me asking them to roll, I'm like, verisimilitude guy. You know what I mean? Like, what are we doing here?
I'm almost there, but I'm still just not quite there. I don't mind when people roll and tell me what it is they're trying to do. Mm-hmm. If they're being descriptive, like, I step into the hallway, but I see the torch comes out to a certain distance. I want to see if I can keep 10 feet between me and where the torch reaches. Lean up against the wall, roll, number shows up. Mm-hmm. And as I try to inch my way towards the corner, I'm trying to do it quietly. I know there's a door down the hall and one behind me, so I can't keep them both in, you know, just do a little bit of that. Mm-hmm. Meanwhile, you're looking at the number I just fucking rolled. Mm-hmm. And as you're listening to me as my GM, you're thinking, okay, the more he talks, the more I'm whittling it down from his entire list of skills to the more appropriate one. Okay, he finally said the thing I need. And then you can tell me what you want me to roll. So that little dance thing that you spoke of a moment ago, that's it for me. That's what makes my brain
sing. That's a more clear delineation.
Yeah, I want the die roll to happen sooner rather than later. Because I don't want to have to, like, stop the dramatic moment to pick up a piece of fucking plastic, roll it, and nobody buys good dice anyways, and nobody can read the fucking numbers. So all five of us are squinting and looking over is that a 16? Is that a 12? No, it's a critical fail.
Well, I have to say, though, like, specifically with you as a player, you have notoriously bad rolls. Uh-huh. But you're playing a fighter, so what'll happen? So what'll happen a lot of times is you'll roll, and you'll be like, "Oh, well, I rolled bad, so it doesn't matter anyway." And I'm like, "No, motherfucker, the DC is 10. Yeah. Like, you critically succeed even with a 2. You know what I mean?" So part of me is just like, I don't want the dice to poison the moment you're trying to have. Mm-hmm. I want you to try and do your moment, and then have reality reflect whatever.
I need to find a way to roll dice to your side of the table and then not see it. When it finally settles, I want you to have a GM screen with a hole in it where I can bocce ball my way to your side of the screen.
Okay, here's what we do. I get my dice tower, my new dice tower, right? I have it set up.
I can't see it. Yeah.
So you can't see it. Maybe I'll have like a 3D printed wall here, and I'll hand you your very visible
that
dice.
That would be legit.
And You describe your thing and stuff like that, and I look down at the thing.
I try to undress the orc goddess with my eyes.
She is amenable to...
Are you sure?
You rolled a 10. So how... You know, exactly. I like this a lot.
I like to see a GM screen with like 5 of those.
Okay,
secret... And everybody has their own dedicated...
Secret rolls GM screen. That is a fucking perfect... We've gotten so far off topic... But that is the greatest idea we've had so far.
We just saved this
for
being a 20-minute video. I'm okay with this.
Secret GM. Secret roll GM screen. Yeah. Okay, we're cooking. We're cooking, ladies
but
and gentlemen.
But yeah, all jokes aside, this needs to happen in Kingmaker for me.
Yeah, absolutely.
That way I don't keep poisoning
I'll
the
just
moment
have you
with
on
those. Because
right.
I hate looking at my rolls after I roll them.
Point at the tower.
Yeah.
Roll. Okay, cool. So let's kind of discreetly describe how victory points work.
Yeah.
As you know, you kind of nebulously describe the problem, And the players come up with things they want to do to solve the problem, whether it be influencing someone, whether it be sneaking around a castle, whether it be chopping down a tree, you know, creating a wedge in the right placement or something like that. You have them roll for it. They either get a critical success, failure, or critical failure that gets them a certain number of points. And when they've reached the threshold of the points, they get a victory condition. If you want to be super cool and gamey about it, and I don't say that with any prejudice, I love me some games, you can create thresholds so where certain victories are better than other victories, so on and so forth. The book even describes sometimes when you win too much, it can have unforeseen consequences.
That was a cool section, yeah. Absolutely. Do you remember the example they gave for that?
I did. You were basically riling up a bunch of workers to revolt, mm-hmm. but then because you succeeded too much, they actually formed a mob and started destroying the city or something
that. Yeah, they're overcorrecting as a victory condition.
Which I love.
I can see that being a feel bad at certain tables, but if I know going in that's a possibility, I'm no longer solely looking at my best skills and my highest numbers. Mm-hmm. I might want to take, a skill with lower numbers just so I don't accidentally critically succeed.
Yeah.
And that's interesting for me.
And to me, I would want to, and this is where you and I might disagree, in a victory system, I would want to very clearly communicate what the thresholds are, mm-hmm. the number thresholds are, and vaguely communicate what the outcomes will be.
Okay.
So I want to communicate to my, let's say,
you want a session zero before each subsystem?
Not session zero, just be like, here's the little mini game I've created for us. Sure. Here are the rules of the mini game. Mm-hmm. You know, if we're chopping down the tree, 5 victory points get you the tree falling down. 10 victory points get you the tree falling down in the quadrant you want. Mm-hmm. And 15 victory points gets you the tree falls in a line that you can draw on the map. So what'll it be?
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, no, that appeals to my video game sensibilities for sure.
Exactly. And obviously you can't describe that to not every problem that you apply victory points to will be that cut and dry, mm-hmm. right? But you could describe it as, hey, there's a victory threshold, which is X number, and then there are 2 or 3 other victory thresholds, and they do cooler stuff. Right. And you might just be able to leave it at cooler stuff, right? So that you have some wiggle room as a DM to kind of
It's also that little bit of extra mystery that makes the players go, ooh, is that code for I can get cool shit if I pay attention and make smart decisions?
Yes.
Instead of just like, I check the treasure chest. Oh.
It's a mimic. Yeah. So that's the system at its core. There's a small section here about diminishing victory points and basically races against the clock.
Yeah, diminishing. I mentioned before there are 3 general shapes the victory point structures can take. Mm-hmm. The first one is primarily additive.
Go up.
And then diminished is this next one we're moving into, mm-hmm. part 2. Yeah. So go ahead.
Number go down. Yeah. It's just number go down. It's basically you have an amount of victory points to start with, mm-hmm. and all of your successes make it so that it doesn't get reduced. So there's a ticking clock where if you do nothing, things will get ruined and ruined and ruined and ruined and ruined.
It's damage control.
And your job is to damage control it and make the least amount of damage possible.
Yeah, so if you're Bob the Builder, you're probably accruing victory points, and you're doing version number 1. Mm-hmm. If you're Indiana Jones running out of the temple with the idol, you're probably doing the diminishing victory points.
Oh, that's a good way to put it, yeah.
So, absolutely. Yeah, I think in terms of movies and video games and
well,
and
in
books.
Our Edgewatch games we talked about in our thing, I would use diminishing for that, because everything is pristine as it is, mm-hmm. and if you're trying to save lives and save the structure, this tower...
I did not do that, and that was a missed opportunity.
Yeah, this tower we're trying to defend, there's a number of victory points there,
right?
And our goal is to have the most at the end of it, you know what I mean? And you could have created...
Because the alternative to that is to find some way to use initiative and combat, mm-hmm. and damage and... Yeah. No, just mm-hmm. victory points, please. Clean thresholds.
Absolutely.
It's kind of like... It feels like it's speaking to that part of my brain that appreciates milestone leveling over XP leveling. Like, I can appreciate math in its place in TTRPGs, and it's even elegant and just beautiful to look at right there. But if I'm trying to tell a story with 1,000 people in a crowd, mm-hmm. and 10 swimming demons and a Godzilla-sized demon coming up... getting into victory points and mini games, mm-hmm. it... it siphons the drama out and creates a space between the players and the mind movie.
Because this is an abstraction.
It's a super abstraction.
Yeah. And sometimes abstractions are really freaking useful. Because the abstraction allows you to stay in the verisimilitude. It allows you to role play more. Like in this case.
Maybe you. I need to pick your brain more about that. Okay. Because absolutely not for me and my brain.
But you just said that in the case of the Edgewatch game, mm-hmm. had we abstracted it to a victory point system, it would have gone smoother for you.
It would have gone smoother, but it wouldn't have been a mind movie. It would have been a mini game. Oh. It would have been a video game.
Mm.
It would have been watching the levers pulled, you know, the
right.
the wires on Peter Pan.
Because that sounds like a lot of fun to me.
It does. That's your brain.
But it also sounds like a verisimilitude thing, because now I can detach from what are the spells that are going to literally stop demons from mm-hmm. getting to this tower to there's a person drowning. Yeah. I cast Don't Drown or whatever. You know
when
what I mean?
Think of you and me and how we tend to see these things, I think of Neo in the Matrix. When Neo's flying around in the Matrix and it looks like he's flying around a city with mm-hmm. trees and sky and clouds, yeah. that's me watching it. When you're watching that same scene, you're looking at all the text coming down the screen to look at all the math. Like, you know exactly why he's flying.
Yeah.
And this bit of code, that's a tree.
This bit of code over here,
you know, that's something else.
I think the point here, though, getting back to the topic, is that if your players are trying to be proactive and do something, mm-hmm. generally you want to use an additive like system of victory points. And if your players are reactive and trying to stop something from happening, mm-hmm. if let's say their hands were tied and they couldn't do anything, everything would be ruined and they don't want that. Mm-hmm. That's when you use the subtractive form of the diminishing victory point system. Does that sound like a fair?
It does. Yeah. And again, without concrete examples, of which there are many in this book.
Absolutely.
It feels like it's not a super useful description, so let's think of some concrete
examples.
The broken
eggs is the one they use in the book.
Yeah.
You've got a horde of dragon eggs that are trying to protect from being broken.
Dragon eggs on the table.
There are 20 points. There are 20 dragon eggs they're trying to protect. They're in a nest in a big cave all over, and you and the players are trying to protect those dragon eggs from getting broken or taken by some thieving kobolds, let's say. So maybe one of the players use a crafting check to board up one of the holes that the kobolds are coming out of. Okay, mm-hmm. roll me a crafting check, Eric.
Crafting check. This is not three action economy. This okay. is me saying I want to
abstraction.
Craft.
You got a 4, you fail. So
is anyone surprised?
Is anyone surprised?
I could have told you that.
In that case, you fail, and one of the board thing you make is broken easily, mm-hmm. and one of the kobolds pops through and steals an egg. You now go from 20 points down to 19 points.
Yeah.
That's a concrete example. Mm-hmm. And had you succeeded, you would have halted the points. And if you had critically succeeded, you would have actually gained a point. You wouldn't have gained an egg in this case, but maybe you would have gained not losing another point from someone else or something like that.
Can we use that same example for the additive victory points?
I don't think you can. In my mind, you're trying to stop something from happening. You're in a reactive position. To me, it would be like, this is one of the notes I wrote, is you could actually abstract an entire combat with victory points.
You could, yeah.
So you have a dragon.
I don't know there are many people that would want to play that, but yeah.
You have a dragon, and the dragon, you need 20 victory points to kill the dragon. Okay, well, my fighter runs up and he attacks the dragon with his sword. He critically succeeds. He gets 2 victory points against killing the dragon. And you can describe how the dragon gets hurt.
Sure.
Let's say they fail and they deal nothing. Or let's say that, you know, the rogue or the druid casts stone shape mm-hmm. and is able to remove the stone between a giant stalactite, and he does it right at the right time, and it falls on the monster or something like that.
You know, yeah.
Two victory points.
I'm going to take back my words I just said. I think people would want to play it, and for whatever reason, it just came into my mind. Mm-hmm. The alternative to what you're describing is roll for initiative. So let's imagine you're in like a war scenario, and there's 100 soldiers on the battlefield, and you're on one end of the battlefield, and the general's on the other end of the battlefield. And you're going to, like, you know, Dynasty Warriors, you know, kind of.
Oh, I loved Dynasty Warriors as a kid.
So,
oh, my gosh.
In the old days, you would roll for initiative and use all of your attacks to go through each individual person between you. That's a 9-hour combat. Or, I don't want that.
Or move between them getting to the...
You got to get like discreetly tactical. Absolutely. To the smallest level. Yeah, yeah. And that's just fucking obnoxious. Mm-hmm. If you can abstract that entire passage, yeah, between here and the BBEG on the other side by having certain thresholds. Mm-hmm. And then things happen as you fail, succeed, yeah, critically succeed, critically fail. So I guess what I'm coming down to is D&D lives in the fourth dimension, as absolutely, you like to say. You can actually shorten the amount of time it takes to tell that combat by using a victory point system.
So the reason I came like to this idea originally was because there is this Warhammer book that, mm-hmm, talks about one, I think it's like one space marine or like one assassin dude who literally climbs up an entire... like colossal dreadnought thing, big giant robot, sure, and that's the size of like skyscrapers, multiple, and can literally destroy entire planets. And he literally kills everyone inside of it as he makes his way up to the very top. Mm-hmm. I think it's like Berserker or something. Anyway, it doesn't matter. I didn't read the book. I listened to someone talk about them reading the book, and it's, you know, an abstraction.
That's how I get my news.
Exactly. But seriously, like, you could roll or run that combat, like a Final Fantasy style combat where you're fighting this ginormous city-sized thing. Maybe there's a giant castle golem, an entire castle turned into a golem that's barreling sounds towards rad, a city, and it's going to destroy the city if you don't stop it. Well,
he's got like a portcullis gates for a loincloth.
That would be amazing, actually. And you got to open up the portcullis to get inside, mm-hmm, right? So... there's a series of checks that you do as you make your way through this labyrinth. Mm-hmm. The alternative way would be to roll combat and, sure, be like, okay, well, you know,
the castle wall's pink on the inside.
Oh my God. You run up to the foot and, you know, you have two rounds to break into the entrance on his foot until, mm-hmm, it moves. And then you have to move again to catch up with his foot. Sure. All right, you're in. Let me draw the foot area, and yeah, you have to move. Make,
you're describing a montage right now, and I really like, yeah, that. How, yeah, to successfully do a montage with a structure to it.
Absolutely.
Instead,
absolutely,
of just like, I watched a million movies, so I know how it works. Not all of us can do that.
If it's a thing, mm-hmm, where there is a victory condition and a fail condition, mm-hmm, you can instead use victory points. You can use it for combat. You could use it for social encounters. You could use it for literally,
yeah,
I can run all of Pathfinder if I wanted to, which I'm not.
You should run all of Kingmaker for the rest of Kingmaker.
With victory
points.
The
next 17 levels.
Exactly, exactly. You could run it with victory points if you really wanted.
Yeah.
And I'm not saying you should.
No, I would do it for the throwaway fights.
Exactly, exactly.
I think I'm going to.
Or maybe ginormous boss battles.
Yeah.
Or abstract boss battles.
Certain parts of the battles. Like right now we're doing the waves of demons. Right. Maybe like it can be abstract initiative order.
Yeah,
or something
absolutely
like that.
And what would be great is if you took the victory point, if you took the victory point thresholds, mm-hmm, and made it so the better you did on the three waves, the better,
sure,
you will be in the fight.
Yeah.
So if you barely succeed the three waves, mm-hmm, it's a standard fight. If you critically succeed or you get the first or second threshold, you get some advantages.
Ooh, maybe the boss fight is not an elite version of the monster, but a weak version of the monster.
Yeah, that's a good way to put it.
There's a bunch of different ways to turn the dials,
exactly,
like a sound engineering board.
Exactly. You could
That's cool. I like that.
You could just reduce the monster starting HP.
Yeah.
You could do
how
a whole
interesting
host of
would
things
that be? Like a monster that on its surface is an impossible fight.
Absolutely.
If you're level 10 and you go up against a level 16, right? Mm-hmm. And the point is to leverage the victory point systems, mm-hmm, whether you're infiltrating or doing reputation or, you know, chasing, and then you add it up and add it up and add it up and add it up so you can reach those thresholds to get that ending. This is some really good stuff.
Exactly.
Take the impossible and make it possible,
exactly,
by way of victory points.
So in the case of our Edgewatch game, mm-hmm, you introduced a bunch of NPCs that we know very well. You know, Skinny and... that's the only one I remember.
Skinny,
Batiste,
and Olo.
And Olo. So what if the three thresholds were them being a part of the final fight against the monster.
Sure. Yeah.
So instead of increasing...
I've seen that in video games. That totally works.
Exactly. Instead of reducing the final monster's HP, mm-hmm. you increase the number of friends and player characters you have at the table right. to fight them, which means that the monster's going to die faster.
Yeah. You know, Lord of the Rings is kind of what you're describing right there.
Absolutely.
Yeah, you know, they won all the victory points. Why? Yeah. Because it was written that way.
Yeah.
But like, what if Aragorn hadn't accrued enough victory points to convince the spectral pirates to come join the fight?
You they love would have died those at the spectral Black pirates, don't you?
It's an easy example because absolutely. Everybody's seen the movies.
Yeah, absolutely. Oh. It's funny because I'm editing a video we shot recently and I make that reference, uh-huh. but I don't have any living memory of that scene. Not because right. I probably have seen it.
It was a good scene, too.
I'm sure I have. But like, I haven't watched the Lord of the Rings. Fake nerd alert. I haven't watched Lord of the Rings movies in years.
Yeah.
So
I used to just listen to it and paint. That's insane. You know, 3 hours. That's
the book. Listen to the book.
No, the movies.
The movies.
Yeah. The what do you call it? The not unedited versions, but the big versions.
Oh God, I can't imagine.
They were good. What are you talking about?
They're fun movies, but like, I have friends who like watch them twice a year, mm-hmm. every year, and
that's
I'm
too
like.
Much.
I don't know how you survive. Like, they are
because the music is phenomenal and the acting is good, even if some of the dialogue is a little.
And the
not.
Pacing is just so interesting.
Oh, I forgot. You're young. You guys don't have patience for like extended storytelling.
No, I'd have patience for it, but long that beats. Movie specifically is pacing is just kind of notoriously slow.
There's a lot of melodrama of in there. Yeah,
you know
yeah.
what I mean. Especially if you watch the director's cut. I have friends who only watch.
That's
the
what I was
cut.
Looking for. Director's cut.
And the director's cut friends. Is rough. There's a reason they cut that movie down. Yeah. Like, jeezy Pete.
I think it's perfect. It's its own thing.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'm not trying to shit on Lord of the Rings because it's fucking Lord of the Rings. You know what I mean? But like, I love watching movies and I can rewatch some movies if they have endings or plot points that change the perspective of the rest of the movie. Mm-hmm. And that means you want, like Arrival by Denis Villeneuve is like one of the greatest examples of that. Mm-hmm. Finishing the movie means you want to watch it again. The Sixth Sense is another movie like that. But like, you don't, you gain very little from rewatching Lord of the Rings for the 9th time. Anyway, this has nothing to do with victory
you know,
points.
Do you bathe more than once a month?
Yeah, of course.
That's kind of the same thing. I'm ready to move on.
All right. What? Okay. I'm not. All right. You got me. But anyway, yeah. So my two main takeaways from this are you can revolutionize combats that and make them more interesting. Mm-hmm. Of course, that's my takeaway. But like, seriously, like you can make combats with big monsters, literally huge size monsters or right. insurmountable monsters.
And you can do that same combat weaker. Either using the additive victory points mm-hmm. or using the subtractive victory points.
How would you use it subtractively?
Oh God. You have a certain amount of victory points, resources, and you spend those resources to get from one level to the next. And whatever obstacles are on those discrete levels, if we're climbing the monster in this case, they're trying to siphon as many of those victory points from your pool as possible. You might run out by the time you get to level 3 of 5 up the monster, and you just can't get any further, and that's a fail state. So it's the same thing with Indiana Jones running out of the temple. I think it's a...
It does create a lot more tension.
Yeah, it's a ticking time bomb.
Yeah.
And it also makes us very careful about the nature of our actions, mm-hmm. because if we have to choose between two actions, one of them is going to cost us one victory point, another one's going to cost us three, we're probably going to be more frugal mm-hmm. unless we're at the boss fight. And right. then we just shoot our wad right there. Right. We take the big actions that cost the most points. Mm-hmm. So victory points are resources to be spent.
See, to me, the ticking time bomb victory resources, like the way I read the chapter, I didn't really read it the way you read it, mm-hmm. in the sense that to me, if the characters do nothing, mm-hmm. bad things will happen and all of it will be gone. And the players are, we would use the diminishing victory points system in a case where the players are trying to stop things from happening rather than do something.
Sure. You
it's
can.
Reactive instead of active. And yeah. it's just hard for me to wrap my mind around using them that way.
It takes a little bit of mental gymnastics. Yeah. So I don't think there's a single story you and I have ever played in the history of our playing tabletop role-playing games together
right.
where you couldn't do any of those scenes both ways. It just requires, you know... It's the additive versus subtractive.
But is one more appropriate than the other?
without an example to go by, okay, I don't know if I can really.
Let's talk about the third
is like important because that's where I live.
Let's slam them together. Yeah.
What it is. Additive and subtractive in the same. And to make this useful.
for the audio listeners, it's just
this is how you get glaucoma, folks.
My two beholder cups, we're making them kiss like we're playing dolls at home. Anyway.
God damn it. Okay, where were we?
We're making them kiss. Multiple point subsystems.
Multiple point system. So I think we should start with an example, and then we can talk about how it works.
You have one that goes up, and you have one that goes down. All right, example.
All right. So they have an infiltration subsystem already baked into the book. It's a couple of pages. It's not super long. Read it.
Or listen to our podcast about it.
We filmed one, didn't we? Okay, cool.
Did we?
So good call out.
About infiltration?
Infiltration? I thought we did.
I'll put it up on the screen if we did.
I don't know. It was ages ago if we did.
Okay.
Must have been one of the first ones. So infiltration subsystem, the gist of it is PCs gain X number of infiltration points while avoiding giving awareness points to enemies through failure states. So if we're trying to creep into an estate and we're doing stealth checks and we're trying to hide and we're trying to stay below notice, we are, as we're successful doing those discrete things, we are accruing infiltration points. Infiltration points are the same thing as victory points. It's just a fancy name for them. Call it what you want. Awareness points are also victory points. It's just a fancy name for another type of victory points. The difference is, where do those points go?
Eric, I have never read this chapter, so we have not done this video. I can't believe we haven't done infiltration.
Oh, this is new for you?
Okay. We haven't done infiltration. I haven't read this chapter before.
It's interesting.
So keep talking.
But yeah, so whatever you want to call victory points, whether we're going to call it reputation points or infiltration points or chase points, they're VPs.
Yeah.
And when you combine the two within a single set of challenges with shared obstacles, like in the case of trying to break into a party at a fancy person's estate, I want my victory points through stealth and to not be noticed. But when I fuck up, I gotta give you awareness points. Mm-hmm. And that the two piles are piling up. And if the bad guys get their threshold reached first, awareness points, oh no, I've been found out. I'm kicked off the grounds or maybe arrested or whatever. So my fail state is when they get more, when they reach their threshold.
Right.
It's a race against the other. And I really like that sort of trying to do the technically proficient thing that I know I can do because my sheet says so.
Yeah.
And I get those points. But at the same time, when I mess up because I make, decisions that I have to make certain decisions, like maybe I'm all stealth and no diplomacy. And a couple of the obstacles are diplomacy obstacles. Mm-hmm. I have to interact with that. And you know that as a GM because you know my sheet. And you craft these obstacles based on my sheet. So that's...
DMs, you have your players' sheets, right? You have your players' skills written down, right? Right, DMs? Right? Like all of us do?
I do sometimes. I don't others. But just the idea of both of those simultaneously is much more dynamic and interesting than I'm just trying to add points or I'm just trying not to lose points. So I like all three for different obstacle collections.
They're definitely appropriate for different situations,
I think.
Like, especially the race against someone else. Mm-hmm. I think that's when this is absolutely perfect. Infiltration, as you've described it, isn't necessarily a race against someone else. It's a counterbalance against someone else. How much am I doing the thing versus how much are you trying to stop me from doing the thing? And if you stop me from doing it before I win, I lose. Okay. Which I think is pretty interesting.
Yeah. I mean, what if it was the same situation and there's three guards and they're patrolling a garden?
Yeah.
And each guard has, five squares in any directions where they can attempt to perceive you.
Right.
And they wander according to random direction dice roll, whatever. Mm-hmm. So you do your series of things and then they do their little automated whatever. If your circles overlap, if you're within their five, their radius, I guess,
right,
then they're acting against you. So it's not solely just the PCs doing things and failing or doing things and succeeding. That is one way to do it.
Yeah.
But there are different ways to do it. And it's basically how many different levers are getting pulled within one set of obstacles.
I can't believe we haven't done infiltration subsystem because I love playing and also running infiltration games.
Yeah, I think nobody watched the video, so we just stopped doing the subsystems after a while.
Yeah, yeah. They're not,
that is one of the more fun ones that I feel like we were building up to because it was a sophisticated one.
It is.
And we started with the easier low-hanging fruit. Yeah.
It looks like it's got some weight. I mean, no one wants to watch research. Let's just be honest. Like, research...
Research should be fun.
But and, it's literally only two pages with a sidebar. Like, the art is hilarious.
When you look
though,
at the thresholds there, like, actually, this is in my notes, is the sample research checks and stat blocks in the research subsystem. Mm-hmm. And there's like a 5, 10, 15, 20, 30 point threshold where.
Erik loves this because he loves excuses to do exposition. And this is all just like.
Did you say I talk too much?
No.
That's what I heard.
You just like, you and every other writer DM likes to write backstory that they know their players will never learn. And this is a subsystem that lets them learn the stuff.
Yeah. And I like nested values.
Sure.
I like value that is nested in value that is nested in value and like a Russian doll.
Right.
You've got to pull them out one at a time to get to the actual secret we're trying to uncover.
Okay.
And this hag secret, just to read a couple of them. No, that's too many paragraphs.
That's a lot of paragraphs.
It's a lot of paragraphs. But the idea of like, I'm just going to half-ass this particular obstacle. Okay, you know, you get your 5-point threshold and you learned, you know, X thing. And then you stop there and you move on with your life. Okay, that's fun. I won, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, if you would have put more effort into it and been creative with it and applied your skills and used the story that we all know so far because we're taking notes and we remember what happened from session to session, you have the possibility of like digging 5 layers deep to get more and more valuable stuff, which may or may not make future combats or altercations easier or harder.
What's interesting about this is it really does some of that stuff we talked about earlier when it comes to you've succeeded too much and it's come to bite you in the butt because the 25 and 30.
You have overprepared for your game.
Exactly. Well, 25 and 30 is like you've researched them so hard. A coven of Anis hags who materialize to destroy the party and their newfound knowledge. If the PCs run out of time before reaching this point, the coven erases any further information before attacking the PCs out of spite.
It introduces a press your luck element.
Yeah, exactly.
Which is something that you just don't have in Pathfinder 2nd Edition.
That's true.
You want higher numbers, and there's no number is too high for us to want it.
That's true.
Until now.
Press your luck.
Know when to stop. And that's an element that just isn't here in our particular game unless we make it be here. And that could be feel bad for players who are like, no, I min-max this motherfucker. I want my triple-digit successes.
Yeah, that's a good point. It's like that's almost like a system-defining thing that they don't necessarily want to add because the majority of their players want number go up.
Yeah.
And adding that, it would be a real, when you pull the rug out from under someone's feet, they've signed up for one experience, and you give them something that's very different, and that can upset a lot of players. And
I think it's a session zero thing for sure.
Yeah,
I think it's just use it where it's applicable and don't where it's not.
The question, are you cool with rug pulls? Yeah. Because, I mean, like, you know, if you ask, I think if you ask everyone in the Edgewatch game except me, they'd say yes. Because I'm that player. I'm like, but I got to...
Did you see the session recap I put on this morning?
I critically succeeded. No,
you should check it out because that was specifically for you.
Okay,
I told you all the systems we're going to be using next session.
Oh, shit.
Yeah.
All right.
You want it. You got it, my friend.
I'm hype. Okay, cool. So I think we've covered... Those are the three base systems. We've got number go up, accumulating rolls. Number go down, diminishing rolls. And both slam together, kissing. Multiple point systems. Exactly. So beyond that, I mean, like... This might be the fastest podcast we've ever done, Erik.
Yeah, I knew it was going to be, and that's.
Do you have any other?
All the other stuff.
Do you have any other input, like any other ideas on how to use this?
Those are the three structures. We talked enough about them. We can shut up now. Obstacles that you put within those subsystems, and the DCs that are affiliated with them. So, for instance, if we're involved in a chase scene, you're the GM and I'm the player, and you say, "Erik, he's got a good 10 yards on you." What do you want to do? Well, I want to roll initiative because I'm a monk and I've got a 45,000 movement speed.
Right.
No, this isn't that kind of chase scene.
Right.
So tell me what you're doing. Oh, I beat feet. I run after him. Okay, so there's like an alleyway, and it's got like an overturned cart. Mm-hmm. Okay, I parkour off the side, and I put my hand on the cart as I'm launching over. Well, that reeks of not athletics, but the other one.
Acrobatics.
Thank you. Acrobatics. So I look at my sheet. Oh, I can do that. Okay, great. I do a critical success. And in your mind, you've got a threshold I'm trying to beat. Mm-hmm. I get a +2 towards that threshold. And then you feed me another obstacle. Okay, there's a pack of Jehovah's Witnesses in the center of the alleyway. And they're peppering you
flurry
with pamphlets.
Flurry of blows.
Flurry of pamphlets. Flurry of pamphlets. And, you know, I've got these watchtowers all over. So what do you do?
I beat
look,
them up.
I'm in a hurry, you guys. I don't have time to be diplomatic, so I do intimidate.
Right, right.
Okay, well, it just so happens that they're not weak to intimidate.
Mm.
They've got a lot of practice with it.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I know this is a terrible example.
This is a bad one.
Bear with me. It gets worse. So my DC in your mind would actually go up.
Right, right, right.
Because I specifically said, I'm trying to intimidate a creature that doesn't get intimidated.
Resisted to intimidation,
right.
Yeah.
So you're giving me the player incentive, the what's the word, the empowerment.
Yeah.
You're giving me the ability to tell you what I'm doing when I'm doing without having to worry about the numbers.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have to look at my sheet. I'm just telling you what I'm doing, and then you're like, oh, DC goes up, DC goes down. And the cool thing about that is, in my opinion right now, and I can't think of a reason why it wouldn't be this way, I think there should be 3 separate skills for every obstacle. One that makes it harder, one that makes it easier, and one that's just baseline.
What about attacks?
If we're using a subsystem for victory points,
mm-hmm.
I think it would fall under any of those skills. So like lore dragons could be that scene in The Hobbit where we fire the arrow into the little weak spot, the Achilles
right.
heel of the dragon, the place
right.
where there is no scale. That wasn't a roll to hit critical success so much as we crossed a threshold in using this language
mm-hmm.
because I wasn't using my hunter lore. I wasn't using any of that. I was using plot lore. You know, I learned it from another NPC and I have dragon lore and I know dragon anatomy. So there are arguments to be made for each of the individual skills in attack.
What I think my point...
Some are stronger than others.
What I think my point is like you can... Because of how Pathfinder is balanced,
mm-hmm.
everything is a trained... Like everything is proficiency. The entire game is proficiency.
Mm-hmm.
Because of that, the proficiencies for attacking are actually worse often than the proficiencies for the other skills.
Sure.
So I don't think it, like in certain circumstances, I'm just saying one of the 3 skills you choose could be a physical attack.
Mm-hmm.
Could be, you know, I'm trying to stop him from going. I throw my hatchet at the top of the chandelier and the chandelier falls. Okay, cool. Roll me an attack roll.
Okay. And that's
not
a
skill check.
DC, that's an AC.
No, it's DCs. Okay. About to blow your mind. DCs are ACs.
They're contextually different is my argument.
AC is DC.
Sure, yeah. When you're looking at it in black and white, absolutely. They're no different than...
From a mathematical perspective mm-hmm. in the game, right. they are effectively the exact same thing.
Right. Contextually, they're different, but what you're talking about, they're the same thing. Totally get that. Both of those statements are true.
You use big words just now, and I don't know...
Don't worry about it. You're confusing me
with your dazzle and your razzle. But my point is like in these chase scenes, you could, if the player wanted to do that,
mm-hmm.
right, to slow someone down, it wouldn't be broken for you to allow them to use their throwing hatchet to attack the chandelier and make it fall
mm-hmm.
because all you would do is set the AC mm-hmm. of the roll or the DC of the roll
mm-hmm.
to whatever the check is by level.
Sure.
And if you look at the math of the game, oftentimes attacks are actually worse many times than DCs by a very small margin. So if you want to let them, if you want to let them do that, they can. And it actually won't fuck the math, like
okay,
at all.
Yeah,
which I think is really cool,
mm-hmm.
because you actually get increases to your skills sooner and more often than you get them to your attacks.
Yeah,
and there are item bonuses, circumstance bonuses, and stats bonuses for all skills.
I never thought of combining the two.
That's what I'm trying to open your mind to. It's like, right, you can do it, and actually it'll be harder for you to attack something than it will be for you to use a skill on something. So, and because it's harder and not easier, I think it's an appropriate thing to allow people to use. We're not entering combat.
Is that presuming that you are maxing your some of your skills?
Yeah. The assumption is that you are maxing some of your skills.
Okay.
So you are, if you're a bow shooter, you've got dexterity. Your to hit will
so
often.
So if you built your character correct, then everything you said stands.
If you're building a character maximally, yeah, which I don't think is it's not a hard thing to do in Pathfinder Second Edition.
Right.
So it's very easy. It's a fair assumption that most people will do it on average. Mm-hmm. Your attack will almost always be lower than a dex based skill. Barring bonuses to hit and damage, mm-hmm, but even then you can get items that give you item bonuses,
sure,
to certain skills way sooner than you get them to attacks.
Okay.
So I'm just trying to open your mind to the idea that you can just set the DC equal to level and then let them attack stuff, okay, and use that as one of your three skills. So in the case of the dragon, I know this doesn't make a lot of, this kind of hurts my brain even saying it, but in the case of shooting the dragon in the niche of their whatever, their, mm-hmm, scale, you could have dragon lore. You could have Arcana, because it's an arcane dragon in this case, or you could have an attack roll.
See, the cool thing about that is the fighter gets to do what the fighter does.
Exactly.
And the wizard gets to do what the fighter does.
Exactly. Exactly.
So, yeah.
Well, the whole point of making three checks for everything, mm-hmm, is allowing different players to come at situations differently, right? Mm-hmm. And I think you should even go beyond that. I don't think you should even... You should have three skills minimum written down for each of these checks that, mm-hmm, you want to do. But if a player comes up with a cool fourth or fifth,
sure,
skill they want to do, or maybe you've got Robert across the table and he wants to find a way to attack everything, mm-hmm, you could still end up make the DC harder.
Right.
At the end of the day, a normal DC per level for a skill will actually be kind of hard for a lot of players, even maximally
that's
effective players to attack.
That's something I'm still struggling to wrap my head around, yeah, in terms of...
It's because everything is proficiency.
Yeah.
Your AC is proficiency, your attack is proficiency, your skills are proficiency, your saves are proficiency. Everything is proficiency. Thank you for coming to my TED Talk, yeah, about proficiency.
that's a lot for me to, yeah, chew on. Yeah. We're going to have to repeat this conversation.
Absolutely. Yeah, yeah. But that's kind of like, I love the idea of you focusing on, and I think what you were trying to get to was that spending a lot of time, like a bulk of the heavy lifting in prep for these victory point systems, mm-hmm, are done in creating the obstacles.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
And we want to make cool obstacles because obstacles are that's the decoration on the cake. You know what I mean?
That's what players are interacting with.
Exactly. Yeah. That's the fun part. So
obstacles are creatures.
Yeah, in a combat situation. So I think creating cool obstacles like let's say the clockwork castle is about to attack the city, right? Mm-hmm. Shoving something in its knees gears to stop its leg from seizing its leg, and I can do two victory points, but I can still, mm-hmm, drag its leg with its other leg, or
sure,
you know, fighting off a bunch of kobolds who are running the machine in the inside. Okay, well, either cast a spell or roll an attack roll or do a crafting check. So like you've got these kobolds inside them, this giant monstrosity that's about to destroy a city, right? Mm-hmm. You can have the fighter say, okay, well, you know, what do you want to do? Oh, well, I want to get rid of the kobolds that are running the show inside. All right, cool. Give me a crafting roll to sabotage it. Give me an attack roll to just kill some kobolds, or give me a... Or do something else. Cast a fireball inside.
This is crazy because the more we talk about this, the further away from the roots of Dungeons and Dragons we're getting, and, mm-hmm, the closer to like Powered by the Apocalypse and, yeah, other, you know, more modern game designs.
Absolutely.
We're getting. So this is a weird sort of like love child between the sacred cow gaming, mm-hmm, sacred cattle gaming, and modern game design.
Well, it's just abstraction is all it is, yeah, at the end of the day.
Yeah. And you know what D&D 3rd edition was not good at? Abstraction.
That's true. It's true. That's kind of why a lot of us loved it, though. It's right. Because it wasn't abstract. It was a simulation of reality with magic in it. And that's what was so fun about it.
Yeah. And then that became 3.5. And then 4 happened. And, mm-hmm, then 5 happened. And, yeah, it's like Pathfinder kind of sprouted up all of that, yeah, because of that fidelity to the rules crunch.
Well, I would
argue... Everything we're talking about here... it seems to be not divorced from that, mm-hmm. but just sort of like, well, wait a minute, we can get fuzzy here. Yeah.
I think what 5th edition tried to do is they tried to have their cake and eat it too. Mm-hmm. They tried to keep abstraction. Oh, sorry, they tried to keep the rules and the simulacrum of reality by creating numbers. But the way they balanced those numbers and the addition of the advantage system meant that from a probability perspective, you could smush a lot of things.
Right, and when you smush, you get that phrase that's repeated. Like, if you took this one phrase out of the player's handbook for 5e, you would probably lose 30 pages. Trust your judgment.
Just ask
your GM.
Yeah, exactly.
There are no rules.
The GM will do more work.
Right. If you take that phrase out of every mm-hmm. everywhere it exists, you would have half a book. The only other thing I really have to say about these subsystems is it's almost more of a question. All the examples that we've come up with so far have been super foreground proactive examples. Yeah. We are here. We are doing the subsystem
in the moment.
Make your decisions in the moment. Right. But what about like having that in the background, mm-hmm. just run invisibly so we can do our adventuring and then systems are going. I know Kingmaker's got that.
Yes,
you're doing a version of that.
Kingmaker has some stuff in it like that.
Yeah, just like automating a subsystem so that we don't have to do the heavy lifting on the player side.
The last two lines in this little victory point scales table is adventure-wide sideline and adventure-wide forefront.
Yeah, that's foreground and background, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
that's so a weird phrasing. They think.
It is. The sideline is, I don't know why they chose that word, but they chose it for a reason, I'm sure. The idea here, goblins who are still watching, is that you can have a long arcing victory plot in your giant narrative, mm-hmm. and every one of the dungeons or major NPCs that they befriend or make enemies of will add or subtract to the nebulous idea of victory points that you've created. So this can be an abstraction that you're not even telling your players about, right. but it just allows you as a DM to contextualize all the things they've done over the course of a game. I'm almost tempted to say it allows you to come up with excuses as to why you fucked over your player so bad. But like, well, if you really want to see the receipts, you guys killed this dude, you fucked up this dungeon, right. da da da. But at the end of the day,
I didn't know we were keeping points.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, I didn't know we were keeping score. Well, you can either be forthright with your players and be like, uh-huh. look, at the end of this line, you're trying to create a better kingdom. Mm-hmm. And a better kingdom as defined by your governmental objective
sure.
is loosely defined as A, let's say. So I'm going to award victory points and subtract victory points from when you do a thing really well. And the problem about this level of abstraction is it's another layer above that where there aren't discrete roles. We've now divorced the victory oftentimes from actually rolling a dice to do that discrete victory. So instead of rolling a survival check and defeating the encounter, I finish a dungeon or I make friends with someone mm-hmm. in a certain way, and that has gotten me a victory point.
Sure.
Because I'm trying to build
my kingdom.
Accruing. And they're, or maybe loudly accruing. Maybe you have a counter of victory points for your players. And after the session is over, mm-hmm. you just say, all right, you guys did X. No. You guys did X and Y. Mm-hmm. You gained 2 victory points for doing X and you lost 1 victory point for doing Y.
Okay.
And maybe sometimes they thought they were doing the right thing, but the victory point was what they thought was right actually was a negative
victory
point.
This feels really Blades in the Dark, doesn't it?
It does. Yeah.
It's that modern game design aesthetic.
And I mean, they talk about clocks in here, right? They talk about clocks. Like, you know, clocks is like a big part of that Blades
in
the Dark mindset.
Did I completely miss that in here?
Yeah, no, they literally, in the diminishing victory points and also the sidebar enemy victory points, they talk about having a ticking clock. Like the whole point of diminishing
victory ticking
points.
Clock, yeah, yeah. Meaning like a, yeah.
Yeah, well, that's what Blades yeah. in the Dark is a ticking clock. They call
yeah,
it a clock.
Okay,
it's
yeah.
literally a clock.
Yeah.
So I think in this instance, and in, like in Kingmaker, if I were to apply victory points to Kingmaker, mm-hmm. right, I would be like, I could create a victory point system for overall happiness. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the game, if you're whole kingdom was
threshold one happy, the very BBEG would get this much power. Mm-hmm. And if they were threshold two happy, they would be threshold two happy. And they would get these, you know what I mean? They would have like these discrete effects at the end of the game.
Yeah.
But your players wouldn't know what those discrete effects were. They would just know this is the first threshold.
Sure.
Okay. And when I hit that first threshold, maybe you will award some experience points to the party.
Yeah, you know, I kind of like that too, because that also brings me back to like Knights of the Old Republic, when you're doing, you know, dark side, light side, gray side, dialogue options. It's the immediate encounters game that you're having.
What a great game.
Yeah, it was, that did wonders for my imagination. So yeah, when you're, where was I going with that? The interactions that you have in the moment affect the world and how it's built for the rest of the experience.
Right.
And it's invisible, because you don't know how else it would have gone. You only know what's presented to you.
Right.
And all that shit's accruing in the background, and you don't have to deal with any of it. Mm-hmm. You just know you're either being a dick or you're not being a dick.
Right.
Or you're just like, you know, not on either side. Mm-hmm. So that's, I like that, because that makes me feel like my character is more relevant, rather than just like, I could have done anything and the last 80 pages of this book is going to happen the same way regardless.
Exactly.
That's old game design.
Exactly.
So that's cool. I like that. I like invisible systems that I don't have to worry about as a player.
And that's the thing. I'm not even suggesting you make it invisible. What I'm suggesting is that
make
you
it visible.
Make it visible.
Yeah. Yeah, you appreciate the visibility. I would
do.
Appreciate the invisibility. And then the other three people around the table are somewhere in
would
between.
Have to weigh in. Yeah, exactly.
That's typically what it is. You're usually on one side, I'm on the other, and everybody else is somewhere in the middle.
That's true. That's, I think that's why the podcast is so incredibly popular.
It's why we need that that milquetoast third person right in the middle.
Yeah,
who's like,
exactly.
I don't have an opinion either way.
Yeah, you're kind of both right, maybe. maybe we need to get Jacques back in here.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know. I loved that podcast episode. It was so much fun.
That was fun.
But it's also like one of our worst ever podcasts.
Yeah.
Like from like doing well, getting views. I put Jacques' face on it and oof.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's what made me want to watch it.
Exactly. Exactly.
That's so, pretty much it for me. My big takeaways for victory point systems is it speeds up gameplay.
Absolutely.
9-hour combats become like 9-minute combats if you do it right. It gives players agency and using their skill sets in ways they wouldn't otherwise be able to in grid-based combat.
Mm-hmm.
By doing abstractions, you actually increase the number of things a player can do.
Absolutely.
I think. So that's cool. And to make it invisible, so I can just trust that stuff is going on out there, instead of me having to make every single change that occurs in the game, that's a lot for a player.
Mm-hmm.
Some people love it. Other people don't.
Yeah.
Everyone else is in the middle.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I like these, whether it's a chase system or a research system or an influence system. They're just little quick montage appropriate mechanisms.
Absolutely. Yeah. My takeaway is that victory points are the base abstraction system for most of Pathfinder 2nd Edition. And when applied, you can apply this multi-tool to any situation you want. You can abstract.
You just need to know how DCs work.
Exactly. All you need to know is the three core foundations of Pathfinder 2nd Edition, and you're off to the races.
Yeah.
Go check out.
Where do you find out about that?
Oh, I've got a wonderful YouTube video.
Does it have Jacques' face on it?
No.
No?
It doesn't. It has my face on it.
Oh, okay. And probably got a few more clicks then.
Yeah, I'm standing on my stairs.
Yeah.
But
love you, Jacques.
But yeah, like my point here is that it's a great abstraction of how the game works at its core. And if you ever have, if you're ever stumped as a DM and you're like, oh my God, what a bear of a combat, or what a bear of an encounter, or what a bear of a challenge I want to throw at my players, abstract it.
Yeah.
Create a victory point system.
I learned that the hard way last Saturday.
Pull it out. Dude, we had a blast.
Yeah.
Stop
I'm glad
that.
You
we
did.
We had a blast.
It was a strange thing.
It
I think
cool.
Everybody had a rough week before that.
Yeah, that's true.
And we all, like myself included, came to the table like, okay, I'm here.
Yeah.
We haven't gamed in a month and a half.
Yeah.
And I'm not about to miss this one.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I'm here, you guys.
Absolutely. Yeah. Awesome. Well, Goblins, thanks so much for hanging out with us.
Yup, yup.
We appreciate your time.
Mm-hmm.
We have a Discord. We have a Patreon. We already told you about it. Please check it out. Like the video. Don't like the video. Comment, though. Tell us what you think. But as always,
make the beholder's kiss.
And keep it weird.